Good evening, everybody. It's so wonderful to see such a hungry crowd, hungry for food for thought as well. It's really such a delight to welcome everybody to this, actually the very first event of the season of the seminar series in Asian and Asian American Studies at ARI. My name is Q Lee. It's just Q Lee, but I just want to say Q. That's my first name. And I was asked the other day whether my name was Q Lee or it was a Q. It's just Q Lee. I am the organizer of this series, and the and I'm going to moderate today's discussion as well. Just want to say a little bit about the seminar series itself. For those of you who are not yet familiar with it, we started last semester, spring 2010, as a kind of sort of study group among the scholars and kind of those who are interested in kind of reading what's going on these days in Asian American studies and related areas. And so ARI very generously and enthusiastically, you know, provided space for some of the professors based in New York and beyond. And so we started off with a kind of sort of idea of incubating certain kind of a group, because there are so many interesting people working, living and thinking here, but we don't really get a chance to really have a intimate space to really to voice our current thinking. And so the start starting was very kind of modest, but still sort of practical and ambitious in that way. And then we thought that we should have a theme every year, so we can sort of focus on those themes. And so the topic that kind of I myself came up with, and I talked about this with a couple of colleagues, and that was xenophobia and philia. So we thought that would be a good starting point. And so we had a opening panel. I think it was the 1st of March, wasn't it, Anthony? Right, 1st of March, right? And you can see a video of that launch event on the website as well. And we had a 7 panelists, public intellectuals and policymakers and academics, all sorts of really interesting and cool people, really giving their thoughts on this topic, xenophobia and philia, as a way to sort of kind of starting the conversation. And after that, then we started the kind of actual series. And so we had 5 meetings in this very room. But it was at the time kind of, as I said, sort of study group for those who are really interested in starting something. And so it was a fairly kind of semi-public, but still kind of unofficial, if you like, in a group. And so I'd like to sort of list some of the events that we did amongst ourselves, so that you kind of know what the orientation is here. And so we start off with the a session involving Crystal Parik from NYU on a discussion around the questions of betrayal, and I was the commentator for that session. And this sort of the way it worked is that we were and also I was sort of mainly thinking in terms of inviting colleagues and friends and scholars who either have written a book or article about a particular topic that pertains to xenophobia and philia, and or are writing a certain piece on that. And so Crystal Parik has got a book on titled Ethics of Betrayal, and so that became a topic for us. So that was the first meeting. And the next meeting was Professor Min Song from Boston College, and Min Song is writing a book involving these notions of expectation, something about the temporality of immigrant experience, etc. And so that became the second topic with the commentary by James Kim from Fordham. Then the third meeting was with Jack Chan. I assume that many of you also know Jack Chan, who's from NYU, who's a pioneering figure in the Asian American studies. Jack is also preparing a book-length study and collection on yellow peril and paranoia and sort of xenophobia, that topic. So we did a session on that with a commentator, Anne Chang from Princeton University. And that was followed by a presentation and discussion with Amina Alexander, who is at Hunter College and CUNY Grad Center. And we also read a number of poems and short writings and from their book around the issue of dislocation. And the book that we've read is called The Poetics of Dislocation, and it's also around the experience of living in and working in Manhattan. And so, and the commentator was Richard Perez from John Jay, CUNY. Then the whole series concluded with a discussion with Ken Chen, as you, again, as many of you will probably be familiar with that name, Asian American Writers Workshop. He's a director of it, and he's got a wonderful poetry, book of poetry called The Juvenilia, right? And so that was the topic for the last meeting, and the commentator was, yay, Jennifer Hayashida from Hunter College. By the way, I am trained in philosophy and literature, and I teach philosophy and other unrelated things in John Jay and feminist theory at CUNY Grad Center. So I'm very much a CUNY girl, in case you're a bit wondering about the gender and age. So, right, and so this is a really wonderful opportunity for me also to kind of showcase what we've been doing. And also from this semester on, we thought that we want to sort of open it up to the public, because we've been having so much good fun. Like, we're having a slightly intimate group, and then kind of after the incubational stage, we thought, you know, it's about time that we open it up to involve discussion with the public, you know, those who are interested in thinking about this. It's very much life issues, right, especially xenophobia, if you think about it. I mean, you don't even have to think of it, you just feel it these days, and philia and phobia as well. I mean, what better topic, you know, can we choose today than this wonderful food for thought that Robert Koo and Linta Varghese is going to provide us with. And before we move on to the actual today's discussion, I also want to announce a little bit, just give a heads up on what's going to happen. We have so far two speakers preliminary scheduled for the follow-up event, and the next one is going to be in both is going to be in November, and the Falguni Sheth, a philosopher from Hampshire College, is going to come and give us a talk and give a seminar rather on Muslim in America, sort of xenophobia and Islamophobia. That's another sort of topic that we can talk about. And will be a commentator will be Alison Cole from Queen's College and the Graduate Center. And we're also interested in having a discussion with May and I from Columbia University, who has got a really wonderful book on happy families. It's called The Lucky Ones. It's about the Chinese American family. So as you can see, you know, this sort of these talks also or seminars. I'd like to suggest as a seminars as an opportunity to really get the conversations around recent publications going, and we can have a conversation. And so that's going to be in November. And so I encourage everybody to sign up so that we can be all on the same page about the event. And please just check the website, or we'll send an email to remind you of some dates. And we are still sort of trying to figure out exact schedules, but these will help happen in November. And so then we are hoping that, you know, we can just keep doing it like at least a few times a semester. So if you have any ideas about topics or anything, just get in touch with us, and we'll see what we can do. Great. And so, again, as I said, this is sort of seminar setting, and sort of something different from sort of conventional talks, where we really want to have some more interaction between the audience and the presenters. And so after the presenters and the commentator, present the material, then we'll really expect to have a really vigorous conversation, right? if not food fight. I'm glad that the food is sort of running out there, so that's good. So we'll have we have a lot of time, so feel free and just enjoy the show. And let me just turn this over to Robert, and who will introduce himself. Thank you.
Thank you. and Ari for this invitation. Is this loud enough? Can you hear me? Yeah? Okay. Q, you said you were a CUNY gal. Well, I'm truly a CUNY fella. I did my PhD in English at CUNY, finished back in 1990s at some point. I also taught at Hunter College. I was the director of the Asian American Studies program for a while at Hunter and also in the Department of English. I also taught at BMCC and other places. So to me, CUNY is home, so it's really nice to be back home. Currently, I'm at Binghamton University, SUNY, upstate. I'm in the Department of Asian and Asian American Studies. And and when Q asked me to perhaps come in and talk about my current project, I was very happy to do so. It's not yet a completed book, but it's a book in progress. It's hope to finish it sometime very soon. So this is a work in progress, so I appreciate your patience. And also thank you, all of you, for coming out. I was expecting like 4 or 5 people, but it's many more, so I really am overjoyed. And Linta Varghese, who I asked to be a commentator for, although she's much more than a commentator. Maybe you can talk about your background when time comes, after I'm done.
Yeah.
Okay. So the book I'm currently writing is tentatively entitled Dubious Gastronomy, The Cultural Politics of Eating Asian in the USA. And here's a brief overview. But it's not. But the tone of it is changed to make it audience friendly. So I hope you don't think it's too irreverent. I love spam. No, not unwanted emails, but the canned meat product marketed by the Hormel Food Corporation. No doubt my birth in South Korea and childhood in Hawaii are principal reasons why. Due to their long entangled history with the US military, these two places, along with Guam, lead the world in per capita consumption of the pink block of gelatinous pork. Immediately following World War II, the American GI stationed in Asia and the Pacific curried favors with the impoverished natives by handing out such luxuries as chocolate, cigarettes, and spam, which as part of the US Army's monotonous sea ration, was an object of scorn and mockery by most of the rank and file. Here in the US, spam is widely regarded as a vulgar, farcical, and an affront to the very idea of real or whole food. To millions of devotees in and across the Pacific Ocean, however, spam is not only an essential part of the local indigenous cuisine, but a luxury commodity as well. In the Philippines, spam is an expensive delicacy, out of reach for most low-income families, but highly desired. Thus, most Filipinos receive spam as pasalubong, or homecoming gifts, from friends and relatives returning home from other countries where Filipinos by the millions live and work. In many Pacific Island nations, such as Gilbert Islands, Marshall Islands, and Tahiti, spam is said to function as a non-perishable form of meat currency that is stocked as wealth like money in the bank. Clearly, this sort of native appropriation of spam symbolism renders the middle-class Americans' low opinion of the product all but irrelevant. Most Americans see spam not as a comestible, but a series of laughable questions. What is it? Is it edible? Is that a joke? To spam enthusiasts like myself, it is not only porky, salty, delicious, but chock full of meaning. With every bite of spam, I consume layers of overlapping histories, migrations, and cultural transformations. With it, I consume calamitous political turmoil, bloody military conflicts, and other upheavals that shaped much of the 20th century. Ridiculous as it may sound, spam and I go together like Thanksgiving and apple pie, or pumpkin pie. And in this, I am not alone. Vast swaths of the Pacific Rim sits alongside me at the table. I also love the California roll, which is now perhaps the most popular form of sushi in the world. I don't even mind the pre-made supermarket variety, even if the rice is routinely too cold and tightly packed. I find nothing wrong with the combination of rice, seaweed, avocado, cucumber, fake crab meat, and mayonnaise. Legend has it that sometime around 1968, when NASA's Apollo 7 sailed the heavens great, Ichiro Mashita discovered the California roll while working as a sushi chef in the Los Angeles neighborhood of Little Tokyo. Machita's clientele were mostly homesick Japanese businessmen. He wanted to serve his discriminating customers something special that reminded them of home, but otoro was in scarce supply. So Machita substituted otoro with avocado, whose silky smooth fresh flesh closely resembled the prized fatty belly of the bluefin tuna. He then paired the avocado with Alaskan snow crab to make a makizushi, and presto, the California roll was born. Given the magnitude of his invention, I considered Machita no less a culinary genius than the Kellogg brothers, who invented the cornflakes in 1894, or Cesar Cardini, the Tijuana chef who invented the Caesar salad in 1924, or Teresa Bellissimo, proprietor of the Anchor Bar in Buffalo, New York, who invented the buffalo wing in 1964. I care not if serious sushi aficionados, Japanophiles, and other mavens of authenticity consider the California roll the poster child of bad sushi. That makes me love it even more. After all, what's there not to like about the California roll? For the novice Epicurean not yet swayed by the hoopla surrounding raw fish, it minimizes most of the dangers associated with raw fish while maintaining the thrill of the exotic. Perhaps this is why most sushi mavens see the California roll as the bane of their avocation, an ugly thorn in their tongue. Often made in the US by Mexican, Chinese, or Korean hands, this dubious concoction befits more the Chinese buffet of the interstate exit than a dignified sushi shop in Osaka, Japan, the sushi pundits say. The California roll is emblematic of a noble Japanese product that has become Americanized, which is an overt euphemism for compromised and bastardized. The California roll. Hardly are those words out when a vapid image out of fast food nation troubles our stomach. Surely the sushi apocalypse is at hand. Surely the end of authentic food is at hand. And what rough beast, the culinary purists ask, is our come round at last, slouches toward Benihana to be born. For me, there's nothing more satisfying than a lunch special at a Chinese takeout. Give me a wonton soup and kung pao chicken over a sandwich or a slice of pizza any day. No less a culinary authority than Nina and team Zagat, co-founders of the Zagat survey, restaurant survey, once described Chinese food in the US as abysmal, compared to the authentic cuisine of Chinese food's native land, by which they mean mainland China. They place the blame squarely on the shoulders of the Chinese settlers who came to California following the gold rush of 1849. There is a historic explanation for the abysmal state of Chinese cuisine in the US, they claim. Without access to key ingredients from their homeland, Chinese immigrants improvised dishes like chow mein and chop suey that nobody back in their native land would have recognized. True enough, but does non-recognition by the so-called real Chinese necessarily a bad thing? How long must Chinese Americans wait before they are no longer compared unfavorably to their supposedly bona fide relatives on the other side of the world? The Zagats are not alone in denigrating American Chinese food, the Rodney Dangerfield of American ethnic cuisine. Dismissing American Chinese food offhand as inauthentic and therefore inedible is a favorite pastime of most self-proclaimed American foodies. I think they are all misguided, if not plainly wrong. I'm sure there is plenty of bad food to be had in China. Just as there is plenty of great Chinese food in the US. Tell me, how can anyone resist a big fat egg roll or a sticky gooey spare rib? They are also biased, if not bigoted, against Chinese Americans who continue to play the role of the patsy in the xenophobic drama that is US history. By their logic then, nothing that Chinese Americans innovate can ever be considered authentic. Nothing labeled made in Chinese America can taste good. Chinese Americans, to use a well-known food colloquialism, is chopped liver. Speaking of Chinese food, I do not suffer headaches, facial numbness, heart palpitations, fatigue, or any other bodily discomfort from consuming Chinese or any other food spiked with monosodium glutamate. In fact, I practically grew up on Sapporo Ichiban Ramen, whose flavor packet is comprised nearly entirely of MSG, with nary a symptom to show for it. I also grew up on American canned food, frozen food, fast food, and Doritos corn chips. all of which are loaded with MSG and other flavor enhancers. Think about it. There are some 3,000 chemical additives in the U.S. industrial food supply. 2,000 of them are flavoring agents, which makes MSG but a single drop in an ocean of chemicals. So why all the fuss over MSG? To be perfectly honest, I am convinced that the widespread report of MSG's health risk is a farce and a sham. In fact, the so-called Chinese restaurant syndrome, the imaginary element linked to MSG-laden Chinese food, is yet another example of Sinophobia that emerged in the late 1960s, one that gave millions of Americans medical license to treat Chinese restaurateurs with anger and hostility. Given that the popularity of Chinese food did not wane during this period, rather it skyrocketed, these angry diners evidently complained with just one side of their mouths as the other side was busy chewing the very food they professed to revile. Consequently, the no MSG disavowal, even by establishment that never used MSG to begin with, is now a compulsory feature of all Chinese restaurant menus, as is the cautionary red chili next to dishes deemed too spicy for the average American tongue. And what of the countless miserable souls who insist MSG makes them feel bad? Jeffrey Steingarten once asked, why doesn't everybody in China have a headache? If MSG-laden Chinese food is the terrible bane of American diners as the mountain of anecdotal accounts make it out to be, why was there no one in, say, Shanghai, the largest Chinese settlement in the world, with a headache, despite the abundance of MSG on practically every street corner? Steingarten answered his own question by accusing MSG complainers of suffering from phony food intolerances. They are all hypochondriacs and psychologically troubled crybabies. In other words, all claims of MSG-induced syndromes are not merely greatly exaggerated, but are entirely fabricated. Believe it or not, this is the scientific consensus. Refusing to accept this fact is akin to believing that global warming is a hoax, and that Charles Darwin was wrong to discount the role of God in the creation of the world. My favorite kimchi is mass-produced in a factory somewhere in Queens, New York. It is most likely made by Mexicans, Guatemalans, and other Latinos. At the risk of sounding sacrilegious, I prefer it to the ones made by the loving hands of my mother and my mother-in-law. Not that they bother to make it anymore. In fact, no Korean I know makes her own kimchi these days. Why go through the immense trouble when you can simply purchase a jar, purchase a jar at any one of the countless Korean markets you find in major cities and small towns across the US. Or for those of you who live in the hinterlands with no such markets, simply order it online and have it delivered to your front door. That said, I'm a little annoyed at how kimchi has suddenly become the food du jour among the hip cosmopolitan foodie crowd. Enough already with David Momofuku-chan and kimchi tacos. Less than a generation ago, kimchi, especially its funky smell, was an object of disgust for non-Koreans and self-loathing by Koreans, both in and beyond the peninsula. Once upon a time, before Kim Yuna became the most beloved Olympic athlete in South Korean history, and Apollo Ono the most despised, before Bae Young-jun melted the hearts of middle-aged women throughout Asia, before the Wonder Girls opened for the Jonas Brothers on the North American leg of their world tour, before the South Korean fried chicken chains Gyochan and Banchan vie for supremacy of Manhattan's K-Town, before the Korean government's unlikely campaign to elevate Korean food into the top five rank of world cuisine, no matter regardless of how that ranked, how that's measured, before kimchi took on its global reputation as a miracle food, and before South Koreans began exporting hundreds of millions of dollars worth of kimchi overseas, that is to say, once upon a time before Hallyu, the Korean wave, transformed contemporary Korean culture into a global and transnational commodity, kimchi was thought to be something utterly off-putting, inconsumable, and most of all, noxious and stinky by non-Koreans. Those were the good old days. Now, Koreans everywhere proudly declare kimchi their most favorite food. Once a symbol of poverty and shame, kimchi is now a superfood. In March 2006, Health Magazine named Korean kimchi as among the five most healthful foods in the world, sharing the accolade with Spanish olive oil, Japanese soy, Greek yogurt, and Indian lentils. And in 2009, the glossy food magazine Savour devoted 10 food color pages to kimchi. Today, from Los Angeles to Chicago to New York City, kimchi and other elements of Korean cuisine are gourmet chic, as chop suey and Chinese food once were during the first half of the 20th century, and sushi and Japanese food were at the turn of the 20th century. And the main reason why so many Americans are now so enthused about kimchi is because the spicy pickled vegetables are seen as authentically Korean, that is to say, as sufficiently alien. It has yet to undergo the process of Americanization, which is considered a death knell of authentic Asian cuisine. Unlike kimchi, dog meat simply is not something that Americans would ever come to stomach. And for this, I thank the culinary gods. It perhaps need not be said that most people in the US find the idea of eating man's so-called best friend abominable. They believe it to be a depraved Asian thing, and a Korean thing in particular. Like horse meat is a French thing, and dolphin meat is a Japanese thing. This is perhaps why I have no problem with the idea of dog as food. The more the people of pet cultures, such as the US, rail at dog eating, the more I feel compelled to champion the practice. In fact, I once went out of my way to taste it while traveling in South Korea, a place that is yet to entirely abandon the concept of dog as livestock. It was not a pleasant experience. I literally lost my lunch while attempting to lunch on it. So am I a hypocrite for extolling the practice of eating something that I myself am physically repulsed by? A couple of years ago at Binghamton University, where I teach, a white male student got into trouble for telling a Chinese American female student to go home and eat a fucking dog. Legs kicking and teeth gnashing, she had to be physically restrained by her friends. This brouhaha confirmed my long-held suspicion that there is perhaps no nastier racial epithet to hurl at an Asian, that is, at an East or Southeast Asian, than dog eater. It certainly feels more offensive to me than chink, gook, or commenting on the shape of someone's eyes. Given that, yes, some Koreans, Filipinos, Chinese, and Cambodians continue to enjoy dog meat, when you tell an Asian to go eat a dog, is it inherently a hostile act? The speaker's intent might be entirely malicious, but is a message necessarily negative or the sentiment automatically racist? That said, what do we really talk about when we talk about eating a dog? Why, it's cannibalism, of course. Cannibalism. Although we are loath to be reminded of it, we know of the violence, suffering, and death that accompany a mouthful of hamburger and a closet full of leather jackets. Subconsciously consumed with guilt, shame, and disgust over the inhumane treatment of animals we deem livestock, we indulge and spoil animals we deem pet, and admonish whomever refuses to share our ritual of categorical purity, such as those who treat dogs as if they were livestock by eating them. Let us, therefore, compensate for our brutal treatment of the cow and the chicken by turning the dog into an honorary human and equate dog eating with the most savage human behavior imaginable, cannibalism. Compared to the miserable cow, the pampered American dog appears to be the luckiest animal in the world. Scratch the surface, however, and you see an equally sad story. For every pup lovingly cared for by a human, many more in the US face a miserable life and a silent death. For each diamond-studded collar that graces the neck of a cherished poodle are many more choke collars that bite the skin of troublesome mutts. For every beloved pooch that sleeps on a human bed are untold numbers that are put to sleep during the dark of night. To call an Asian a dog eater is to accuse her of symbolically engaging in the most debased culinary practice known to man. As people capable of eating perhaps the most anthropomorphized animal to ever walk the earth, Asians are indeed anthropologically deranged. So what I say? Dog eating, like man eating, like cow eating, is not for the squeamish, which is fine by me. If these admissions of love and tolerances for dubious Asian foods make me a culinary rube, if it means I have no taste for truly good food, if it means I dishonor the sanctity of authentic Asian food, well, so be it. I'm not ashamed to admit it. I'm a big fan of Titanic. No, not the RMS Titanic, the passenger steamship that struck an iceberg in 1912, but the movie that struck pay dirt 85 years later. I've seen it numerous times, so many times in fact that I cannot account for the exact number. Directed by James Cameron and starring Leonardo DiCaprio, Titanic has grossed nearly $2 billion worldwide and chose only Avatar, the 2009 film also directed by Cameron, as the most profitable in cinematic history. Titanic is also among the most decorated, with a record 14 Academy Award nominations and 11 wins, including one for Best Motion Picture. Despite its successes, or rather due precisely to them, the film has garnered neither critical nor scholarly regard. Titanic has been derided by some as a crude, tawdry, manipulative example of cinematic art, closer to the kitsch of the Poseidon Adventure and the Love Boat than the artistry of Battleship Potemkin. The contempt for Titanic is not limited to the film itself or its creators. Some believe the audience, like someone like me, deserves more of the blame. The LA Times film reviewer Kenneth Turin once described Titanic as a witless counterfeit of Hollywood's golden age, a compendium of cliches that adds up to a reasonable facsimile of a film. But he did not stop there. He also dismissed the legions of devotees who flocked to the film, many repeatedly. He accused them of being mainstream, that is to say, of being conventional, conformist, and common. They are desperate people, he averred, deadened by exposure to nonstop trash spewed forth by producers of contemporary popular culture. Did I mention I love Spam? It is the Titanic of preserved meat. Nearly 7 billion cans have been sold thus far worldwide, and Americans purchased 90 million of them each year. Despite its popularity, or precisely because of it, Spam is likened to culinary trash. It is a canned meat version of the Twinkie. The ingredients are said to be completely mysterious and the shelf life unnaturally eternal. Like McDonald's hamburgers, over 100 billion sold and counting, Spam is commonly regarded as a witless counterfeit of gastronomy's pre-industrial golden age, a compendium of throwaway animal parts and synthetic chemicals that adds up to a reasonable facsimile of human fodder. But is this really so? Am I really a cultural Philistine for repeatedly consuming not only Spam and Titanic, but also the Big Mac? In his elegantly incisive book about the cinematic worth of Titanic, the film scholar David Lubin writes, "When I began telling my friends, colleagues, and students that I was writing a detailed analysis of the blockbuster, I was surprised at how few of them had seen it, or at least were willing to admit they had. Eventually, this response proved so predictable that I eventually switched gears, or to use a metaphor from the film, reversed engines and now have come to be surprised when someone I know actually says, 'Oh yes, I've seen that film.' The greatest surprise of all is when he or she adds, 'And I loved it.'" Substitute Spam for Titanic, and I am quite familiar with the scenario. It is rare to run into someone who admits to having tried Spam, and even rarer to find someone who admits to delighting in it. That is, with the exception of those intimate with the quotidian food ways of Hawaii, South Korea, the Philippines, Japan, Guam, and other Pacific Rim locations. When I happen to mention to people that I am writing a book about Asian food, a typical initial response is something along the lines of, "That's great, I love Asian food." When I expound on it, however, explaining the book deals with subjects like Spam, California Roll, American Chinese food, MSG, and factory-made American kimchi, a befuddled look usually follows. In truth, this is a reaction I entirely expect. Despite the copious amounts of General Tso's chicken And supermarket sushi consumed in the U.S., or perhaps due precisely to that reason, many people, and so-called foodies in particular, do not consider these products as legitimate examples of Asian food. They see them instead as witless facsimiles of wondrous Asian gastronomy corrupted by the dark forces of modernization, or, God forbid, Americanization, which is perhaps the dirtiest word in not only academic fields such as anthropology and postcolonial studies, but also in common food discourse, such as restaurant reviews, food and travel TV shows, and everyday conversation. Does Americanization equate to the loss of integrity of indigenous foods? Does it mean the erosion of some essential flavor or taste? For those who reflexively define American influence as an apparatus of cultural disruption, destruction, appropriation, and theft, I suppose, to borrow a phrase from Ernest Hemingway, it's pretty to think so. It is easy, if not expedient, to characterize U.S. cultural influence as simply as hegemonic and imperialist. It is easy to argue that the consequence of Americanization is solely of indigenous cultures worldwide teetering on the brink of annihilation. That the influence of American culture is almost always detrimental to the integrity of Asian food is a belief shared by both Asians and non-Asians alike. In fact, it is more likely that someone of Asian descent or a non-Asian with an extensive knowledge of Asia to be dismissive of such foods. More than dismissive, they are often annoyed, if not downright hostile, at the idea that anyone could confuse ordinary Chinese takeout for real Chinese cuisine. Avocado or mayonnaise as a legitimate sushi ingredient, or MSG as a safe, delicious, and natural flavor enhancer. A common belief is that what popularly passes for Asian food in the U.S. either does not exist in Asia, or that so-called real Asian people would not recognize, let alone eat any of it. But there's a limit to all this desire for authenticity, as demonstrated by the feeling of horror evoked by dog meat, which is seen as too authentic, as hyper-authentic, and therefore dangerous to the civilized sensibility of the average American. Therein lies the rub, to misquote Hamlet. For all intents and purposes, the cultural legitimacy of Asian food in the U.S. is measured against a standard that is impossible to live up to, a largely mythical, if not entirely imaginary standard based on the food of so-called real Asians, who are defined as Asians who live there in Asia, not here in the U.S. Not only there, but a there that is culturally static and disassociated from historical time. Never mind that this presumably authentic Asia is a figment of our imagination. A function of what we have come to call Orientalism. Clearly, the Korea, Japan, China, and the Philippines of yesteryear are radically different from what they are today. Surely the tremendous transformation Asia has undergone over the past two or 300 years is directly a consequence of coming into contact with the West, including the U.S. Likewise, the changes that have taken place in the West and the U.S. during this time, same time, are directly linked to the influence of Asia, Africa, Oceania, and other non-Western worlds. To compare the legitimacy of Asian America against the standard of Asia is to ignore this historical reality. It is to ignore the evidence at hand and cling to a pretty fantasy about the sanctity of purity. It is to define change, fusion, and hybridity first and foremost as a process of contamination and pollution. To those who cherish the notion of purity, Asian Americans cannot qualify as real Asians because their Asianness has been irreparably compromised by their Americanness. At the same time, they cannot truly be American because their Asianness disqualifies them as such. They are thus considered doubly counterfeit, doubly ersatz, doubly inauthentic. Asian Americans are to Asians in Asia what spam is to real meat, what American Chinese food is to food in China, what the California roll is to sushi in Japan, and what kimchi made by Latino hands in New York City is to kimchi made by humble-clad Korean women in Korea. In other words, the Asian presence, whether gastronomic or corporeal, in the U.S. is a dubious thing. Neither legitimate nor authentic, neither this Asian or that American. It is perpetually liminal, always conditional, never value-free, and unnaturally hovers above, below, and in between easier discrete categories. And like Titanic, The more Asian Americans either enter or are embraced by the mainstream US, the more dubious they appear. I believe Asian Americans share a special fellowship with spam and other dubious Asian food, an intellectual, cultural, political, spiritual, and personal fellowship that forms the foundation of my book. The Asian presence in the US is watered down, counterfeit, inauthentic, at least when measured against a largely mythical, if not entirely imaginary standard of so-called real or authentic Asia. That is to say, compared to Asia, Asian America is anything but kosher. It is impure, unclean, hybridized, which I argue is not necessarily a bad thing, but rather actually quite delicious. Think about it. How much blander would the US be without Asian Americans? The word kosher refers to food and food practices that conform to Jewish law. Spam is made of pork and is therefore treif, the Yiddish word for any food that falls legally short. According to Mosaic law, a person who ingests an impure animal becomes an accomplice of evil. Pork denotes evil because its source is the pig, an animal that symbolizes filth, which is an impolite term for the one thing the Hebrew people detested most, hybridity. The pig is a detestable hybrid creature because it meets only one of two criteria that defines a land animal as God intended. Although the pig has cloven hooves, it does not chew its cud. Like a human, the pig is an omnivore. Unlike the cow, sheep, or goat, the pig is not a ruminant. And as an animal that resists easy categorization, the pig is impure. Of course, the ancient Hebrews were neither the first nor the only group to detest hybridity. One could argue that the fetishization of purity in one manner or another is an obsession shared by all collective identities, ancient or modern, be it religiously, ethnically, nationally, or morally organized. Even a seemingly democratic and pluralistic society as the 21st century U.S. betrays his discomfort with hybridity in his schizophrenic attitude toward matters of race, immigration, and sexuality. The U.S. is not unlike all nations in treating both the alien and the queer as clear and present dangers. In a sense, aliens and queers are perceived as hybrids that straddle the boundary or blur the distinction that most Americans hold religiously dear. Citizen versus non-citizen, documented versus undocumented, white versus non-white, Christian versus non-Christian, male versus female, straight versus queer. The hybrid is a dubious thing, neither entirely this nor entirely that, neither entirely us or entirely them. In a word, the hybrid is not kosher, not merely in a religious sense, but perhaps more importantly, in a broader secular sense as well. While the literal meaning of kosher is based on religiosity and ceremony, the term also has a secular application in English, a colloquialism that began at the end of the 19th century and became increasingly fashionable throughout the 20th. Figuratively, kosher can mean any number of things: correct, genuine, legitimate, authentic, proper, admissible, or acceptable. None of these terms befit Asian Americans, who are impure, inauthentic, which I'll argue is not a bad thing. Rather, as many bacon-loving Jewish friends of mine can attest, non-kosher can be quite delicious. This is not merely a matter of taste. It is more importantly a matter of national identity and cultural citizenship, which are always amorphous and continually shifting. My book explores foods and culinary practices that have at least two things in common. First, each is not only strongly associated with Asia, but is commonly found beyond Asia and the US in particular. If not materially in any significant way, then certainly as a topic of contentious conversation. Second, each is or once have been an object of ridicule, scorn, disgust, and bemusement, particularly to mainstream Americans. That is to say, each has or once have been viewed as dubious food, and thereby share a certain spiritual connection with Asians in the US who are considered dubious people. These foods, namely spam, California roll, American Chinese food, mass-produced American kimchi, MSG, and dog meat, are commonly understood as examples of either bad or ersatz Asian food, or not Asian at all. With the exception of dog meat, which most Americans associate exclusively with corrupt Asia, all are strongly associated with the corrupting apparatus of Americanization. Each are suspect because it either presumably originated in or has crossed over too far into the U.S. mainstream. By exploring the other side, as it were, of what is typically understood and expressed as authentic Asian gastronomy, I argue that the changes to food cultures taking place today in such far-flung locations as Los Angeles, Honolulu, New York City, or even Baton Rouge are no less critical to understanding the meaning of Asian food than changes that took place in the Orient, say Tokyo, Seoul, or Shanghai centuries ago. By extension, then, I argue for the legitimacy of Asian identities, experiences, and cultural forms beyond the geographic bounds of Asia. When it comes to matters of such as food, diasporic Asia, including Asian America, matters a great deal more than most mavens of gastronomic authenticity are willing to concede. But instead of vying for the equal authenticity of Asian American cultural practices beyond Asia, I challenge the saliency of the very notion of authenticity, a concept that I find troubled, troubling, and troublesome. In conclusion, I have a question. If Spam, the California roll, or American Chinese food is the epitome of cultural artificiality, of culinary artificiality, of spurious gustation, and the antithesis of culinary authenticity, then what, pray tell, is its opposite? That is to say, what does authenticity on a plate look like? If vindaloo, the protein certainly must be pork, not lamb, using none other than Kashmiri chilies without potatoes, prepared by an actual Goan in Margao and not a Bangladeshi on Manhattan's East 6th Street, does it not? If bulgogi, isn't it closer to the version served at the Sorabo restaurant in Seoul, made with thinly sliced ribeyes marinated in rice wine and nashi pear, rather than the Rachel Ray version, which calls for a whole flank steak rubbed with McCormick Montreal steak seasoning, serve atop a bed of faux kimchi, a god-awful mess of bell peppers, and canned sauerkraut? Surely, if the culinary apocalypse is indeed at hand, the rough beast is 30 minutes and $40 a day come round at last, has to be Rachel Ray, doesn't it? Is it a qualitative gulf between this and that, between authentic and apocryphal gastronomy, self-evident, conclusive, and as wide as the Orient itself? Besides, doesn't the authentic always, if not always already, taste better? Had John Berger opted to write Ways of Tasting instead of Ways of Seeing, he might have equated the desire for culinary authenticity to the bogus religiosity of food, with food color illustrations of how the fear of the present, the fear of the demise of authentic dining experiences due to modernity, globalization, and industrialization of food waste, leads to the mystification of the past, where inequalities appear noble, hierarchy thrilling, and the magical possible. I believe this is a condition unique to our time, a condition I call, I propose to call, the cult of gastronomic authenticity. By this I mean a quasi-religious, fashion-driven system of veneration directed toward a particular set of comestibles that are rhetorically organized along racial, ethnic, national, or regional axis. I use the term cult quite deliberately here, as I wish to maximize the shamanistic or priestly dimensions of gastronomic authorities who wield a special kind of cultural, economic, and emotional power over not only the words that come out of their mouth, but also the viands that go into ours. A pronounced characteristic of the system is an extensive admiration for and pursuit of culinary elements that promise to faithfully recreate or at least approximate as close as possible undisputed origins. Here I follow the semantic lead of Edward Said, who describes the word origin in contrast to the word beginning as a unique miracle that cannot be duplicated or incarnated within the absolute boundaries of human life. Origin is a term that is almost theological, Said explains, in that it must be understood in the strictest sense possible. This is a word that best suited to buttress mythological beliefs or religious dogma. Beginning, on the other hand, is eminently secular or Gentile. In short, while origin concerns what we construe to be mythical, mystical, or sacred, beginning inaugurates something temporally historical. For example, while the origin of humanity may be biblical Eve, the beginning of all living humans is mitochondrial Eve. Questions of authenticity typically appear only after subject matter is feared to have undergone significant transformation, such as Americanization, and are indicative of a profound doubt the consumer has over the legitimacy of a cultural commodity. The result is a creation of the desire and subsequent search for a mint version of the damaged goods via imaginative travel to a more paradisial place and time. All claims of authenticity are passively derived through a narrative of origin. The promise of culinary authenticity transports us back to the golden era of human gastronomy, a mythical time when every fruit was organic and livestock hormone-free, a pre-lapsarian larder of Eden, if you will. Foods haloed with the rose-colored aura of nostalgia, often for someone else's invented past, is the holy grail of today's recreational diners and forlorn expatriates, whose need for subsistence is trumped by a need to fill the more urgent spiritual void. To cope with the unbearable ennui of the present, we must travel to a nobler, if not more vibrant past, so that a worthwhile future might be secured. Culinary authenticity is one of those time travel vehicles. Arjuna Purdarai contends that authenticity measures the degree to which something is more or less what it ought to be. To ought, I would add must, shall, should. Given that authenticity is a norm of some sort, Purdarai wonders who exactly, to borrow a Bushism, is the decider. Does authenticity emerge from the thing itself, or is it an external norm reflecting some imposed gastronomic standard? Who's the ultimate voice of authority? The professional cook, the average consumer, the gourmand, the housewife, or perhaps the connoisseur of exotic food, the tourist, the ordinary participant in a neighborhood cuisine? Unable to come up with defensible answers, Apurwai likens authenticity to a mirage, which you obsessively pursue even as it invariably vanishes just when we think we have it within our reach. In this respect, authenticity is the white whale of modern Epicurism, tirelessly pursued by cosmopolitan foodies and displaced migrants in search of the perfect meal despite heavy tolls of spiritual anguish and financial diminution. Authenticity is also Godot, the anticipated company that fails to arrive despite encouraging rumors, signs, and promises. If something does arrive, accompanied by extortionate fanfare, it rarely, if truly ever, lives up to expectations. The best that could be hoped for is a conciliatory simulacrum, a diminutive but true-to-scale proxy of the thing itself, say the Eiffel Tower on the Las Vegas Strip, in place of the genuine article on the Champ de Mars, with one crucial difference. Imagine Alexandre Gustave Eiffel never built a tower, that the Exposition Universelle never took place, that the Las Vegas Chamber of Commerce made it all up. Imagine if what happened in Las Vegas really has not happened at all. Thank you.
I'm an anthropologist at Vassar College, and sorry, Robert. And my food has, I mean, my work has nothing to do with food, but perhaps the most salient thing you need to know about why I'm up here is that Robert and I were roommates for a very brief span of time, and one day I came home and he had actually emptied the refrigerator of all the food that he thought I shouldn't be eating. So, I do. So, Robert and I and food, long, long relationship. So I'm put in the position of playing the straight man, I think, to Robert's great paper. So I'll start. While I was reading the paper, can everyone hear me, by the way? Okay. While I was reading the paper, I was reminded of a student's comment in a class. I can't recall the exact precipitant, but the course was titled, very grandiosely actually, America and the World. And it was an attempt, as my little description said, to move our study of the United States outside its borders. The student had returned from junior year abroad in China the previous semester, and ever since she said that she had been on the search for real Chinese food. After some discussion about what, you know, comprises the real and the authentic, the differences between between Chinese food in the United States and in China, maybe similar to what the Zagats were discussing, I suggested that we think of standard Chinese food in the United States, food that the students had decided was inauthentic, as authentic American Chinese food. And I also told them about this great cuisine in India that's Indian Chinese food, which is nothing like American Chinese food. And if anyone ever wants to try it, you can go to Curry Hill. Chinese mirch is really good. So, okay. I had hoped that the proximity of the word authentic and the hyphen joining the two identities of American and Chinese two identities often positioned as opposites would reveal the problematic foundations of our discussion. But alas, my suggestion did not take us down this path, and somehow we ended with someone else declaring that Chinese food in China is what real Chinese people ate, while Chinese food in the US is what Americans ate. Okay, it was a rich comment, for it placed American Chinese food within the symbolic economy of belonging in the United States, and national cuisines do a lot of work in creating ideas of belonging. But it placed Chinese people in the United States outside of this economy. I would argue that this wasn't an assertion of exclusion, but rather a somewhat confused attempt to acknowledge the loss of the purported true and genuine culture that's often caused by migration, or people think it is caused by migration. As an Americanist, I was disturbed by an inability to see the long, complex history that American Chinese food reveals. As an anthropologist, I was troubled by the recourse to cultural authenticity, which fixes cultures in space and time, and the easy way that consumable items such as food, clothes, and music have come to position culture as a collection of quantifiable practices, rather than as a complicated system of meaning. With apologies to Upton Sinclair and the Jungle, I had aimed for their minds, but I had hit their stomachs. I had hoped that my suggestion would force us to consider the act of reading, not only eating, American Chinese food, to see in the myriad dishes of takeaway joints experiences of migration and exclusion and insight into new social and cultural forms. I began with the story because it really brought home for me Robert's discussion about the importance of beginnings, those temporally historical points which are often pushed aside as we look for origins. The class discussion about authentic Chinese food touched on, but didn't adequately address, like Robert has, many topics and concerns in the paper. Topics such as circulation, travel, the production and consumption of food, who holds definitional power, and the way that food is often used to gauge authenticity and construct multiple boundaries. The essay gave us a way to approach these types of discussions outside the binary framework of authentic and inauthentic, a framework that often leads to a frustrating dead end. And I really thought Robert's opening was brilliant, not only because it was like a confession, it's like, I love spam, a very unapologetic, you know, declaration, really, but because it quickly moved us from a geography of cultural production, right? So spam in Korea, Hawaii, Guam, Japan, the Philippines, and the Marshall Islands to its political economy by tying spam to the, I don't know if it was in this, okay, by tying spam to the presence of the US military in these places, and thus setting up both inventive cultural production, but then also the systems in which these things are produced. So I wanted to highlight what I saw as Robert's engagement with two spheres of analysis, cultural production and political economy, because I think that holding these two frameworks simultaneously provides a way out of the discussions about what's authentic and what's not authentic, right? So first, now these are ordered. First, something that I kept thinking about when I read your discussions of spam, California rolls, MSG, the hands that make kimchi, and the conception of dog meat, is Mary Douglas, the anthropologist Mary Douglas's assertion that those things that we often consider dirty and impure are, in her famous phrase, matter out of place. Okay, so these are the acts and habits and objects that do not fit into prescribed systems of orders. And it's worth noting that she actually made this argument through a reading of Leviticus, so another system of kind of eating and not eating. I may be extending Douglas's arguments to the limit and perhaps even kind of going beyond the limit, but I saw in Robert's paper numerous systems of order that are crossed, right? So including the national order, the integrity and order of the body, and I feel like I have to confess that I'm one of those people that are like, I can't have MSG, I can't have it. The reproduction of the family through passing down of culinary knowledge. So, of course, if these Korean mothers aren't making kimchi and it's mainly Latino men and women, you know, the sanctity of the family through cuisine is being broken. And, of course, the very ordering of which species are permissible as food. Okay. Second, I wanted to talk about the fear and anxiety about Americanization. This is a term that's obviously problematic in the ways that you name, and as an anthropologist, I'm going to reveal myself a bit. Anyway, the problematic issues are that it overstates a reach of U.S. cultural imperialism. It underestimates the creative and assimilative practices present in every culture in the world. And it obviously believes in a mythic, authentic space, which is seen as under attack and must be protected. But I'm kind of loath to let go of the term, or at least some of what the term is pointing to. Okay. I think there's potential in the phrase if we rework it to indicate as much about the process as we do about the end product. Take, for example, one of my favorite examples, the McAloo Tikki Burger, which you'll find in every McDonald's in India. And it's if you like starch, this is your dream come true, because it is a spiced potato patty between hamburger buns. Some people saying mmm or ugh, because it's totally mmm, really. Okay. So I think the McAloo Tikki Burger, which now I was reading today is expanding to the Middle East and parts of Southeast Asia, where there are large South Asian populations, shows that Indian cuisine, you know, whatever that might be, and I just want to take a moment now to point out that two of the things that are heavily associated, well, three of the things, really, if I think about it, that are heavily associated with South Asian cuisine, tomatoes and chilies, come from the New World, right? And potatoes are not indigenous to India, and we might want to imagine what a South Asian cuisine without those things might look like. Okay, so the McAloo Tikki Burger shows that Indian cuisine isn't going to be supplanted anytime soon. And it's, I think, you know, as much as I do like McDonald's, they're delicious, like Robert said. But as much as I have problems with how they work, I think that hybrid forms such as the McAloo Tikki Burger gives us ammunition against people who decry that Indian culture is disappearing under an assault of burgers and fries. But the reason that I want to kind of, we can get rid of the term Americanization, but maybe looking at the process of Americanization would lead me down the path of political economy. Right, so for me, in this formation, or in this concept, Americanization would point us to the astronomical amounts of money that the US government gives McDonald's to set up restaurants in other nations, and the corporation's practices of importing wholesale agricultural systems that rely on monocropping, single corporate buyers, and almost total control over the materials which farmers use. And what this means is that they want to use as many products grown in India as they can, but they'll contract with a farmer and say, you can only sell to us, you can only make this product, and you can only buy seeds and fertilizer from us, right? And they're in cahoots with other people. All right, so in other words, I want it all, really. I want to be able to critique the very real political and economic power that the US does exert, while at the same time questioning notions of authenticity. Okay, so it would be a wonderful world if I could do that. So the third thing, I was wondering about the generative potential of dubious identities and cuisines. And I think that part of the rush to, you know, trying to claim authenticity, especially, I mean, I appreciated your point that often it is Asian descent people that will be like, this isn't really authentic, right? And I think there's kind of a jumble of political acts in there, but I do believe that ideas such as hybridity give us a way out. My issue with hybridity is that it has an assumption of some kind of purity in the back that got joined as time went on. But I like dubious because it's kind of, you know, I think embracing the identity of being dubious is kind of like giving a finger to someone. Like, you don't really care. And that's an okay place to be sometimes. All right. My next question, which I think might be outside of your paper a bit, but it's something that just popped into my mind was about food politics. And, you know, it's like every other week there's an article in the Times or something about obesity and the epidemic of bad eating habits, and, you know, how this is going to drain public resources. And I think as much as discussions about authenticity in food, this is the other discourse of food that's circulating. And these discussions often have a really racial and class component to them, since populations that are identified as most at risk tend to be populations of color and poor populations. And what I'm always struck by, and this is why I started thinking about it in relation to Robert's paper, is that questions about access, right? So like questions about economics and power and access and structural exclusion quickly slide into questions about people's morals. Like they just don't have enough self-control, they're too lazy, and they just don't know what's good for them. So I'm just wondering if you see kind of ideas of dubiousness intersecting with these discourses at all, and perhaps the way that the way that Asian cuisines enter into it, but it seems that Asian cuisines might enter into it as being like the best for you, the greatest, the best. Okay, so now I just have a few questions to wrap up. So I was actually curious to know how producers and consumers of dubious gastronomy are classed, right? So why should I be excited about the latest fusion restaurant in my neighborhood in Brooklyn, but kind of, you know, walk by the Chino Latino place on the corner that has okay nachos? I heard we talked about this a bit before we came, but I was interested to learn more about the ways that the Korean government is really trying to elevate Korean food and how it might involve Korean Americans or diaspora Koreans. And my final question, Robert, is really, you didn't say so in your paper, but why do you love the Titanic so much? You talked about why we shouldn't like it and how it's looked down upon, but nothing, you didn't reveal yourself at all on that. So that's my commentary.